Hi, welcome to Virginia Time Travel, your portal of the Commonwealth's past, present, and future. When we think about the long history of Northern Virginia, you might think about George Washington or George Mason and people running around with powdered wigs. But actually, the history of Northern Virginia goes back thousands of years. And our guest today is senior archaeologist with the Fairfax County Park Authority, Mr. Christopher Sperling, who is going to tell us about Native American Northern Virginia. Chris, welcome back to the show.
Hi, thank you for having me.
So, when did the first inhabitants arrive in Northern Virginia?
That's an excellent question because we don't know. this is a matter of a lot of dispute right now. So, traditionally, we always assumed what we used to call the Clovis First theory, and that was that there was a land bridge that connected Asia and America when the glaciers trapped a lot of the water, dropped the sea level enough for people to come over, and that would have happened. Then they would have migrated from the western, what's now Canada, United States, over into the east. And that only happened. We know when the temperatures and the climate changed, and we know when they would have been able to. And they would have been in this area, have arrived here probably about 12,000 years ago. The problem is that we kept on finding sites with radiocarbon dates that dated earlier to that.
Yeah.
One of the most famous in Virginia is Cactus Hill, and then there's the Meadowcroft Rock Shelter.
Where are those?
Cactus Hill, I forget which county it is. I want to say it's Nottoway County, mm-hmm. But I might be wrong about that. Central Virginia. And then in western Pennsylvania is a rock shelter site that was excavated years ago called Meadowcroft. And these were yielding radiocarbon dates that were earlier than it was possible for people to have arrived there via the land bridge. And they were being found in context with artifacts. So then we started hypothesizing about how are the other ways that people could come. And there are several researchers right now who believe that some early inhabitants actually came from the other direction, came across the Atlantic from the Iberian Peninsula. And they found artifacts in the Chesapeake Bay that are made of materials that are from the Iberian Peninsula and are from what there is known as the Salutrian culture. Unfortunately, there are lots of ways that rocks can make it from Europe, one of which is ballast in ships. But that's one of the explanations that they've used, and that's probably the most common now for those who believe that their Clovis were not the first peoples to have arrived. And that could have been as early as 20,000 or even more years ago. One of the problems that we have is we think that those people would have stayed really close to water. And over all the years, of course, we've had a lot of sea level rise, and so those sites would largely be underwater. But we do have some evidence that's, and I think some strong evidence that suggests that they're pre-Clovis people.
Okay, so let me rephrase that question. What's the earliest artifact that we have?
Well, that's also a great question. I brought a replica of the oldest artifact that we have in Fairfax County. This is a resin cast, and that is a Clovis point. And the Clovis people were known as hunters, and that would have been a point that would have been used on a spear tip. The Clovis people lived in very, very small bands and would have been highly migratory and would have been in this area probably about 13,000 years ago until about 10,000 years ago, 10 or 11,000 years ago.
Now, I know they found one of these in Alexandria. How many of they have found in Fairfax County?
Very few. And one of the problems that we have is not only are very few found, but and I believe I did a search, and it really is just a handful, less than 10, that I know of from this county. And one of the problems that we have is that there's been a lot of development, and the places where people like to develop are the same places that Native Americans wanted to live, places where the ground stayed dry, but they still had access to fresh water. The other problem that we have is context. We generally don't find Clovis points in context. And the Clovis, the spear point itself, is how we date a site. We look at the point, and if we don't have any other means like radiocarbon dating, then what we do is we try to find other artifacts that are in context. The problem is we very rarely find these in context. They're either disturbed through development or if they're in an agricultural area, they may have been plowed and mixed with other artifacts from later periods.
Mm-hmm. Now, these earliest people were nomads, so they were mm-hmm. hunters and gatherers.
Mm-hmm.
So when did they start becoming agricultural?
So archaeologists really break this into three periods. The first, and it's probably very much a misnomer, but we think of the Clovis as being primarily focused on the hunt, and so we refer to them as hunters. The next phase that we have is hunter-gatherer, which in many respects should be considered gatherer-hunter. We've looked at modern hunter-gatherers, contemporary modern hunter-gatherers, and we find that a considerable amount, well over half, of their dietary consumption comes from gathered materials.
Mm-hmm.
And that would have been, again, about 10,000 years ago. There is a climactic episode where even though the temperatures have been very, very slowly, very, very steadily warming, all of a sudden it drops. And it's usually right after that that we see this transition. And we don't know if this means that new peoples were coming in with new technologies. We do know that they have new technologies. And these are what we call our hunter-gatherers, or what we refer to as the archaic period. This is actually another stone tool from the early part of the archaic period. And one of the things that we believe, you can see it's considerably smaller. One of the things that we believe we're seeing as a technological difference is the shift from spear technology to a what we call the atlatl and dart technology. And the atlatl is what we call a dart thrower. And the dart being a very sleek, very long projectile. And the atlatl effectively elongates the arm. I tell my students that if anybody's been to a dog park and seen one of those contraptions where you put the tennis ball, it's the same thing. It elongates the arm, which then allows you to launch the projectile with increased velocity. With increased velocity, you get increased distance and you get increased accuracy. We also think that they're probably hunting smaller game because after the big climactic episode, that was what was more readily available. That goes through a number of stages where in the early archaic, we think that people's migrations are very similar to the earlier hunters. And then after, you know, over the course of thousands of years, starting 10,000 years, going up until 1,500 years ago, we see this shift where the sites become more seasonal, and we're seeing more of a seasonal rotation. And what they're probably doing is they're realizing that gathered materials are a more reliable food source. And what they're doing is following things as they're coming into season, and then choosing to spend the rough seasons, particularly winter, at the most advantageous places, places where maybe they have a southern exposure, you're not getting cold wind right off of water, and becomes more cyclical and more seasonal. And these are just some examples. Again, I like to emphasize on how we date sites. And this point, and let's see if they actually have the years in here. This site, this point is also a replica, would have been probably about 3,000 or 4,000 years old. Again, right kind of in the middle of what we refer to as this archaic period. But you can see with all of these points, they're all slightly different. And really for us, what I refer to as the working end, the tip, that stays the same. It always, yeah, always has to do its job. What changes are these bases and the general overall shape of these projectile points.
So each one of these represents an advance or a change in the technology?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And probably, even if they are being employed in the same way, say atlatl and dart technology, we still see the use of spears. But we also think that it relates to the cultures, that we have people who are moving, who are migrating, and perhaps even shifting. And then either through any whatever processes, whether they just decide for cultural reasons that they want to leave an area, or if there is a new group coming in that's forcing people out, that then the type and the shape of the projectile point will vary as well. So it's both a function of time and, we believe, culture.
So most of the Native Americans here, they're in temporary encampments and then they move south during the winter, is that?
It depends on their migration cycle, and that's one of the things we really don't know. We have things that we'll refer to as base camps or as resource procurement, where they're going and they're finding places where they can find very workable materials. Here in Fairfax, we have a vein of quartz that runs kind of through the diagonally through the counties, southwest towards northeast. And this quartz is not the most easily workable material, but it's also very hard. And that tends to be what we find our materials made of during this archaic period, and actually really from the archaic period the whole way through until contact. When you're asking when we got more into the settled period, we see settlement as a function of the introduction of agriculture. Mm-hmm. Agriculture came from Mexico and then would have come up north and was predominantly maize or corn. And we see some really interesting innovations when that happens. First, I think that people are a little wary. They've had thousands of years of a certain, what we call subsistence strategy, the way people get by. And so they kind of want to, you know, dip their toe in the water. They stay relatively seasonal in their migrations, but then they start playing with horticulture. They start adjusting. And then you start getting to this notion where, rather than me going to the resource, can I bring the resource to me? Mm-hmm. And that's when you really start to see the changes. So what they're doing is then it doesn't pay to move. If you're actually putting crops down, you can't move. And we also see technological changes with that. One are these smaller triangular shape points. And with the smaller size triangle shape points, what we believe you're seeing is the shift from the atlatl technology to the traditional, what we consider bow and arrow technology. Mm-hmm. And again, these are very technologically important adaptations. They work towards greater accuracy, they work towards greater efficiency, and greater range. However, if we're talking about the introduction of agriculture, we all know there's an agricultural season. They have to find a way of storing the goods for extended periods of time to get them through the winter and until they start sowing again. And with that, what we see is the advent of pottery. Uh-huh. And that's what we call Potomac Creek. That's the type of pottery that natives would have been using in this area right about the time that John Smith arrived.
Oh, wow.
And one of the things you'll note about Native American pottery in this area is that it's unglazed. And I believe that that's actually an important component, because if they wanted stable temperatures, then they probably would have buried it. So they would have buried it, but moisture can get trapped in the soils. So what they're doing is they're using the porous clay as a means of drawing moisture away from the goods that they're trying to keep dry, and then enabling those then to stay, to not perish.
So now, was this the first pottery?
No, we have much earlier pottery. Really as soon, and that transition from the hunter-gatherer lifestyle into the more horticultural lifestyle, we changed the name. The hunter-gatherers we refer to as the Archaic period, and then the transition into horticulture we refer to as the Woodland period. And very late in the Archaic, they are using soapstone bowls, which is also native here to Fairfax. We have soapstone quarries, and there are places where you can see the soapstone has been extracted, and specifically to be formed into these bowl shapes. And what I find really interesting is then when they start moving away from the soapstone bowls and into fired clay pottery, you need a temper. You need an aggregate that's in there to help bind. And the very, very earliest pottery we find, the temper is soapstone. And I think this is a way of that kind of continuity of material kind of, again, easing into from one technology into another.
Now, you said that agriculture had come up from Mexico. Mm-hmm. So I guess that means that there was trade.
Mm-hmm.
And what were people here trading?
Well, the trade is fascinating because when we think of our lives today, we have transportation hubs. We have ways that we get around. For Native America, the rivers that we think of as obstacles would have been the highways. So if you're looking at trade patterns, the best way is looking at the river networks. We know that by the early part of the woodland period in this area on over to the eastern shore, we have peoples from the Midwest called Adena. And if it's not the actual people, then it is certainly their goods and certainly their culture, because there's a very distinctive point type that is Adena type. We know that that's coming over. I don't know what we're giving back. The other part about that and is fascinating is that we also have to remember, we don't think about it much now, but places like Great Falls or Falls Church, all these falls around here, that's because this zone called the Fall Zone cuts right through. We have a small portion of Fairfax County, which is in the coastal plain, and then there's the Fall Zone and then the Piedmont. The Fall Zone is characterized by a relatively drastic change in elevation. It's called the falls because this is where we find our falls. It's also later what would have powered our mills, what would have in the historic period. But for natives, that would have been an impediment. Mm-hmm. That because it's you can't row up the falls. But what that also means is that that area, and this was found when people excavated in Washington, D.C., it's also a, for lack of a better term, a rendezvous point where cultures from the Piedmont or from the mountains are coming in and exchanging goods with peoples from the coastal plain. When you're getting into much larger scale trade and then much, much further in the United States, in the desert Southwest, they found evidence of macaw. And the closest place that you can have macaw naturally existing is southern Mexico. Mm-hmm. So we know that even then that these networks are coming. And what I think is probably happening is you do have a movement of people, and then those people are bringing new technologies. Information passes, mm-hmm. And it may take a little bit of time, but it's surprising. And I think it basically follows your water networks.
So how long did this flow of information take to reach, well, say, from Mexico to here? Mm-hmm. Is it hundreds of years, thousands of years?
It would have been over the course of I would say, roughly 1,000 years. Mm-hmm. Once people see that there is a certain advantage to agriculture, they are relatively quick to adopt it. It's stable. But with it also comes risk. And one of the things about it is you have to be sedentary. Mm-hmm. And as soon as you become sedentary, then you can potentially become a target. Mm-hmm. Also, if you have other groups that are engaged in the same type of and other cultures in close proximity, this can lead to conflict. Mm-hmm. And another one of the things that we see, particularly late in the woodland period, probably starting around 1200 AD, 1300 AD or so, is the emergence of what we refer to as palisaded villages, closely set log walls going around. Mm-hmm. And we believe that at this point there is a lot of competition between neighboring groups and neighboring cultures, and that this is a means of protecting these village sites.
Well, see, that's kind of interesting, because you would think this area would be rich in, you know, food and animals. Mm-hmm. So what is it that they were fighting about? I mean, it's not scarce resources.
Well, one of the things is when you become dependent on agriculture, it's kind of in for a penny, in for a pound. Yeah. And it, you know, it's the whole lifestyle. You know, one, imagine if all of a sudden one of the all of the supermarkets in the country shut down. Yeah. You know. I have a lab full of projectile points, but I don't really know how to go out and use them to procure what I need. once the culture becomes adapted to it, and there's evidence from Jamestown. There's evidence in the soils. When we excavate very, very sealed, intact things, we take these samples and we process it in a very, very fine mesh in water. That allows things to float up, and sometimes those are things like pollens and things like seeds. And the environment is very, it will change very quickly to adapt to a changing environment. And one of the things that they learned from Jamestown was that when the colonists, and one of the reasons the first colonists had trouble, is the entire region had been in a period of extended drought. The species of grass that were growing were the much more durable species. And grasses in particular respond quite quickly, and this told researchers that they were in drought. The other thing that we have is power. in Virginia, going from the northern part of North Carolina into Virginia, into Maryland, primarily along the coastal plain, was what was called the Powhatan Empire. They used to refer to it as the Powhatan Confederacy. But these were groups of loosely allied tribes, for lack of a better word, that we believe shared very certain similar cultural traits. They probably had a very similar language, most likely mutually intelligible, and they paid tribute annually to the Powhatan. What's neat about here in Fairfax...
So the Powhatan is a title as opposed to a name?
Yes, it is the title.
Oh, I see.
And
as we always read about, you know, Powhatan down at Jamestown,
right.
I at least always thought it was a name.
It was, and I want to say that there's a European royalty, and offhand I want to say it's the Duke of Anjou, and as soon as a person rises to that level, their name becomes William. And it was the same thing. It was a title, and I don't want to say an honorific, but it designated that this person was the leader of this broad, loosely allied group. The allied tribes would pay tribute, and that also got them protection. But we know that here in Fairfax, John Smith traveled all up the tributaries and mapped out an amazing map.
Now, was John Smith the first contact for the Native Americans in this area?
Possibly. Again, I always like to say, information travels and word travels, and oftentimes over considerable distances. When the first Marylanders arrived, local natives were trying to scare groups by saying that it was the Spanish. Well, the only Spanish were the Spanish from the 1500s in Virginia. In other words, within the course of a generation, two generations, knowledge about that mission in central Virginia had made its way to St. Mary's City. Mm-hmm. So we know that through the 1500s, we had periodic stops by particularly Portuguese fishermen up in the New England, Newfoundland, and so did knowledge, and very possibly did goods, because being rare, being very difficult to get, goods would have been high value, and so they could have been used to being trade. So I think it's very possible that there was a knowledge of Europeans before John Smith, and that there may have even been some goods that were around, but John Smith was certainly the one with whom they first had really first contact.
Now, I've read somewhere that some people have speculated that the Spanish might have gotten as far as Occoquan. Is there any truth in that?
I don't know. I don't know of any archaeological evidence of that. I really can't say.
Mm-hmm.
But when John Smith came, he mapped out all the villages, mm-hmm. and there's only one major village in Fairfax County called Toxinant. And this is kind of the dream of every archaeologist, is to find Toxinant, because we know it's along the Occoquan, or was along the Occoquan. Whether it's been lost to sea level rise or other factors, development, we don't know. But when John Smith stayed here, he said that this was a powerful group, and that although they were culturally similar to the Powhatan, they were not tributaries. They did not pay tribute to the Powhatan, mm-hmm. so that they were an independent nation, for lack of a better word, probably closely allied and perhaps even related, either intermarried with the Piscataway, in where we think of in Prince George's County, Charles County, Maryland.
Now, the Potomac River gets its name from one of the Native American groups here. Mm-hmm. Maybe you can...
I don't know exactly what, and I think it may be, and I might be wrong about this, I think it may actually have been a Native word. We do know that there was a very large Native village very close to what is now Washington, D.C. That would have been one of the other ones that John Smith mapped. That village, one of the early Virginians, a band by the name of Henry Fleet, was held captive there when he was trying to trade. And then when the first Marylanders came, he went with the Marylanders. The Marylanders took him, and he acted as a translator, a guide, kind of a cultural exchange, a very valuable person. But that village would have been up around what's now present-day Washington, D.C.
I see. And I believe there are actually some Native American sites around the Mount Vernon estate.
Absolutely. Again, when we think of these rivers, and the Potomac especially, as being a highway, not a barrier, these positions, first off, they're on a height, easy access to springs and to the highway, and very, very close to that fall zone coastal plain transition. Would have been a very, very advantageous place for them. And that's where we really look. We often look at the tributaries of major rivers where they conflue with their major tributaries.
Well, Christopher, we want to thank you for coming and sharing this with us. It's absolutely fascinating, and didn't even get through half of my questions.
Sorry.
And I give you our new book, Civil War Graves of Northern Virginia.
Oh, great.
A little gift.
Excellent. Thank you.
We want to thank all of you for tuning in to Virginia Time Travel. Please visit our website at www.timetravel21.com, and we'd love to hear from you at timetravel21@yahoo.com. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.